just have a couple notes about worship this evening before we begin. First, a special welcome to our visitors and guests who are with us this evening. Welcome to West Nidaros. On behalf of the congregation and Pastor Jared, and I say welcome to all of you this night. Tonight, at this service, we do celebrate a milestone with our fourth graders as they will be receiving their first communion. And so during that time, part of the service, we're going to ask our first communion fourth graders to come forward with your families, and you will come forward to the communion rail, kneel, and you will receive your first communion first. And then once all of the families and fourth graders have received the elements, return back to your seats, and then the rest of us will commune this evening. We'll commune through continuous communion up front here, and so you can come forward and receive the body and blood Jesus Christ in bread and wine. And so we do celebrate with those fourth graders and their families this important milestone this evening. On Ash Wednesday, you came forward and you received the imposition of ashes upon your forehead, hearing these words, "You are dust, and to dust you shall return." And so during our time of confession and forgiveness, we will go through that, and at the end, you will be invited to come forward if you should choose to the communion rail. Just come forward in an orderly fashion and receive the individual absolution. And so you can kneel down and you'll receive the individual absolution with the laying on of hands, hearing those words of Christ himself for you, and as soon as that is done, you can return back to your seats. Also with communion, if you are a visitor or guest, all who believe and are baptized in our Lord Jesus Christ are welcome at his table, and so you are welcome to come forward this evening. At this time, I do invite you to stand as you are able as we begin worship with our confession and forgiveness. Friends in Christ, in this Lenten season, we have heard our Lord's call to struggle against sin, death, and the devil, all that keeps us from loving God and each other. This is the struggle to which we were called at baptism. Within the community of the church, God never wearies of forgiving sin and giving the peace of reconciliation. And so on this night, let us confess our sin against God and our neighbor and enter the celebration of the great 3 days, reconciled with God and with one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all of our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. You may be seated, and all who would like to come forward for the individual absolution, you are invited to do so. invite you to stand as you're able as we sing our opening. Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray together our prayer of the day. Holy God, source of all love, on the night of his betrayal, Jesus gave us a new commandment, to love one another as he loves us. Write this commandment in our hearts, and give us the will to serve others as he was servant of all. Your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated.
First reading comes from Exodus. said to Moses and Aaron in the land of Egypt, "This month shall mark for you the beginning of months. It shall be the first month of the year for you. Tell the whole congregation of Israel that on the 10th of this month, they are to take a lamb for each family, a lamb for each household. If a household is too small for a whole lamb, it shall join its closest neighbors in obtaining one. The lamb shall be divided in proportion to the number of people who eat it. This is how you shall eat it: your loins girded, your sandals on your feet, and your staff in your hand, and you shall eat it hurriedly. It is the Passover of the Lord, for I will pass through the land of Egypt that night, and I will strike down every firstborn in the land of Egypt, both human beings and animals. On all the gods of Egypt I will execute judgment. I am the Lord. The blood shall be a sign for you on the houses where you live. When I see the blood, I will pass over you, and no plague shall destroy you when I strike the land of Egypt. This day shall be a day of remembrance for you. You shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord. Throughout your generations, you shall observe it as a perpetual ordinance. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God."
Our second reading comes from 1 Corinthians, the 11th chapter. "For I received from the Lord what I also handed on to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night when he was betrayed, took a loaf of bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.' In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes.'" Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Gospel lesson for this Maundy Thursday comes from the Gospel of John, the 13th chapter. I invite you to stand for the reading. "Now before the festival of the Passover, Jesus knew that his hour had come to depart from this world and to go to the Father. Having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them to the end. The devil had already put it into the heart of Judas, son of Simon Iscariot, to betray him. And during supper, Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he had come from God and was going to God, got up from the table, took off his outer robe, and tied a towel around himself. Then he poured water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel that was tied around him. Came to Simon Peter, who said to him, 'Lord, are you going to wash my feet?' Jesus answered, 'You do not know what I am doing, but later you will understand.' Peter said to him, 'You will never wash my feet.' Jesus answered, 'Unless I wash you, you have no share with me.' Simon Peter said to him, 'Lord, not my feet only, but my hands and my head.' Jesus said to him, 'One who has bathed does not need to wash except for the feet, but is entirely clean, and you are clean, though not all. For he knew who was to betray him. For this reason he said, "Not all of you are clean." After he had washed their feet and had put on his robe and had returned to the table, he said to them, 'Do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, for that is what I am. So if I, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet. For I have set you an example, that you also should do as I have done to you. Very truly I tell you, servants are not greater than their master, nor are messengers greater than the one who sent them. If you know these things, you are blessed if you do them." Jesus said, "Now the Son of Man has been glorified, and God will be glorified in him. If God has been glorified in him, God will also glorify him in himself and will glorify him at once. Little children, am with you only a little longer. You will look for me, and as I have said to the Jews, so now I say to you, where I am going, you cannot come. I give you a new commandment, that you love one another just as I have loved you. You also should love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. You may be seated. Dear hearers of the word of God, grace to you and peace from God our Father, and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious God, on this Maundy Thursday, this night that you give us a new commandment, this night that you give yourself to us in bread and wine, your body and blood, open our ears to hear your word, that we may know that you are with us, that you have commissioned us to go forth, and that you forgive us. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Reading this gospel lesson made me think of a lecture one of my seminary professors gave, and he talked about love. And he said, watching the movements of a couple who have lived together for decades, you might get a glimpse of what love looks like. As they move together as one, walking next to each other, gently holding on to each other for balance, stability, foundation. You can see the gentle movement of a hand moving toward and holding on to an arm, whether for balance or just out of love. You can watch the subtle hand on the small of a back, the gentle words of patience spoken for the other. He said, when you watch couples who've been married for decades, it's like a dance that they don't even know they're doing. You may see them in the doctor's offices. As one goes in for the appointment, the other patiently sits in the waiting room, reading the paper or the book they've brought. You may see them at Perkins or the local diner as they sit and eat another meal together, anticipating each other's needs before a word is spoken, knowing the other likes a little bit of pepper, and maybe slapping a hand away from the salt shaker, depending on what the doctor has said. You've seen this. You may live this. You see, these are not self-serving acts of love. They are living examples of genuine love. Love of which Paul writes in 1 Corinthians when he says, love is patient. Love is kind. It's not envious or boastful. It's not arrogant or rude. It does not insist on its own way. It's not irritable or resentful. It does not rejoice in wrongdoing, but rejoices in the truth. It bears all things. Love believes all things, hopes all things, endures all things. If this was the measure of love that Paul has given us, I believe we have failed miserably at it. You see, love is work. Love is service. To love is to be humbled. Love pours itself out not for its own sake, but love is to be poured out for the sake of another. You see, true love does not attach strings to it. Strings like, if you do this for me, then I will love you. You see, that's not love. Not genuine love. That is to be focused on yourself, to be turned inward, which we call sin. No genuine love is often seen in the ordinary, in the day-to-day, and we can see it all around us. We see it when a father cares for his children. We see it in the gentle words of a caring mother. We see it in grandparents as they read their grandchildren one book after another, and it's astonishing to me because they never get tired. The grandchildren or the grandparents. You see it in families and friendships as we live and move together in this life. As a father gently protects and comforts his daughter, or a mother tenderly cares for a child, for a sick child. You see it in friends who show up when you so desperately need them. Not because you asked them, because they just knew, I need to go. You see it all around you. You see, God has given us these vocations in this life, not for our own self-aggrandizement, not so that we can become right with God through them, but God has given us these vocations so that we can serve our neighbor, so that we can do things for the sake of our spouse, our parents, our children, our friends, and not just when it's easy, but especially when it's hard. Especially when it's hard. All vocations lived, or all of our vocations we live here on earth and not in heaven. Because God has given us these vocations in order to live and move in his good creation that God has entrusted to us. And so our work on this earth is to be poured out for the sake of our neighbor. As Christians, this is our work. This is our commission. As Luther said, we are free from all so that we might be subjects of all, servants of all. But here we must remember that the kingdom of heaven is not the kingdom of earth, and the kingdom of earth is not the kingdom of heaven. They are separate, and they must be, even as we are still citizens of both. This means that all of our work for others is not what gives us salvation. All of the things we do for others does not earn us salvation. But it is a good work to help others. It is a good work to help those who are in need. It doesn't make us right with God. In the upper room that night, that Thursday, before the Passover, Jesus does something that shocks his disciples. Jesus gets up from the table and he washes the feet of his disciples, something that not even slaves were forced to do. And in doing so, he reminded them, not only in action but in words as well, that a servant is not above their master. And then he commissions them. He commissions them to go out and to serve others. For I have set you an example, so go out and abundantly, even recklessly, care for other people. And not just those who are lovable, but especially those whom the world deems unlovable. Especially those who are hard to love. You see, Jesus has given us a heart to do this. Our hearts, the hearts that we want to cling to and hang on to, want to serve themselves. They seek what they desire. But the heart that Jesus gives heart that Christ alone gives us is a new heart. And it's a heart that sees the needs of others and does something about it. Not for salvation. We don't even do these works for God. And we don't, especially don't do them for us, that we might feel better about ourselves. But we do them for the sake of the one who is being served. We do them out of love, out of mercy. And this is love, to be poured out for another. Parents understand this. Grandparents understand this, especially. As we pour ourselves out, in fact, as we are poured out for the sake of our kids and grandchildren, friends can experience this as well. You see, this is who Christ has made you to be. Of service, not just to those in this community, not just to those in your immediate family, but to those throughout the world. The washing dirty feet isn't the only thing that Jesus does as he eats his final meal with his disciples. On the very night that Jesus was betrayed, knowing that his betrayal, in fact, that his betrayer was at hand, Jesus does something astounding. Jesus gives his own body and blood to those who would betray him, to those who would deny him, to those who would abandon him. It's in great contradiction and defiance, then, of his betrayal that Jesus says these words, "This is my body given for you. This is the cup of the New Testament in my blood shed for you, for the forgiveness of sins. You who will betray me and deny me, I give myself to you." In other words, his body is handed over and his blood is shed by the authorities of this age. But Jesus remains sovereign, and with the bread and the wine as his testament, as his estate, Jesus now bequeaths his body and blood to his disciples as sheer, unmitigated promise, as pure gospel. "I know what you will do, and still I give you the goods. I give you my promise. I give you my body and my blood." And there Jesus institutes his supper, what we call the Lord's Supper, which he does for you. For you who have betrayed him. When you come forward, that's what you are confessing. "I have betrayed Christ." And yet he still bids me to come. "Take and eat, take and drink for the forgiveness of your sins." Come forward, you who have denied him. You who have run and abandoned him. You see, Jesus isn't deterred by your sinfulness. On the night of his betrayal, he didn't sit at the table and say, "Well, I know where you're going, and so I'm not going to give this to you." Instead, as his hands touched the hand of Judas, he gave himself over. So he does what only Jesus can do for the unworthy, for those who betrayed him. Gives himself, even to the point of death, even death on the cross, so that you may have life, not in yourself, not in this world, but so that you may have life in him. And so tonight, come forward and receive what Jesus has bid you to come and receive. Receive what Jesus has given. His own body and blood in the bread and wine, that you may have life in him. And so tonight, you fourth graders, you were welcomed into the church in baptism. And there our Lord Jesus Christ laid claim to you by name. Tristan, you are mine, Jesus said. Tristan, you are mine, Jesus said. In the water and word of baptism, Christ laid claim to you by name, and you became a member of his body. You became a member of his church. And now tonight, you will come forward and you will receive what he has done for you. You will receive your forgiveness in bread and wine, which is Christ's body and it is his blood. And so tonight we celebrate this milestone for you and for your families, that you will come, and from now on, you will receive Holy Communion. So tonight, this is a special night for you, for your moms and dads, your grandmas and grandpas, your godparents, and those who've come out to be a part of this with you. And we pray now, as a community of faith, we pray as a people of God, that you would continue to come forward and receive what Christ has given you. Forgiveness and eternal life in him. So come, take and eat, and take and drink, for Christ commands it. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which surpasses all human understanding, your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. We sing our hymn. Church this evening were written for us by our fourth graders who will be receiving their first communions tonight. And so we pray what it is that's on the hearts and minds of our fourth graders. As Jesus calls us to love one another, let us pray for the church, the world, and for all in our need. I pray for my family, food, water, animals, and Jesus. I pray for everyone and everything. I pray you help keep everyone safe, happy, and together. I pray for those who are suffering and those who are going through pain. I pray everyone is happy always. Lord, in your mercy, Dear God, I pray for family and friends. Dear God, I pray everybody love you and everybody prays for you. Dear God, thank you for life. Dear God, I thank you for making life. If you didn't make life, I wouldn't be here right now. So I thank you for making life, me, and everybody else around me. Lord, in your mercy. Thank you, God, for blessing these children and helping to prepare them for First Communion in the future. Dear God, thank you for giving me such great family and friends. Thank you for everything. Dear God, I pray for my Uncle Cody and family. Dear God, I am thankful for my house, my family, and my brothers. Dear God, I am thankful for my friends, family, and life. Thank you, God, for life lessons. Thank you, God, for my pets. I pray for school, to learn more, and to never give up. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious God, we give you thanks for these fourth graders who will receive their first communion this night. We pray that they may feel your presence in the body, in the bread and the wine, your body and blood. We pray that it would give their faith something to cling to. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious God, we pray for those who are sick and those who are suffering. We pray especially for those who are hospitalized and those who are recovering. We pray for those who are in need in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious God, be with your church these 3 days as we mark your betrayal, your crucifixion and death, your glorious resurrection. May our proclamation go far beyond our walls to a world that is in need of what it is that you have given. Lord, in your mercy. Trusting in your abundant mercy, O God, we commend ourselves and all for whom we pray into your care. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let's take this time to share God's peace with one another. As you finish sharing God's peace, you may be seated. Our worship continues this evening as we receive your offering. invite you to stand as you read. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it for all to drink, saying, "This cup is the New Testament in my blood, shed for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. You may be seated. Come, for all is now ready. At this time, I invite our fourth grade First Communion students and their families to come forward, kneel at the communion rail, and receive your First Communion.
Thank you.
to strengthen you and keep you in his grace. Amen. Let us pray. Lord Jesus, in a wonderful sacrament, you strengthen us with the saving power of your suffering, death, and resurrection. May the sacrament of your body and blood so work in us that the fruits of your redemption will show forth in the way we live, for you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. This time we continue our worship as we strip the altar, and as we strip the altar, Psalm 22 will be read, and towards the end the lights will go off and you're invited to leave in silence.
My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me, from my words of my groaning? Oh my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night, but find no rest. Yet you are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel. In you our ancestors trusted. They trusted, and you delivered them. To you they cried and were saved. In you they trusted and were not put to shame. But I am a worm and not human, scorned by others and despised by the people. All who see me mock at me. They make mouths at me. They shake their heads. Commit your cause to the Lord. Let him deliver. Let him rescue the one in whom he delights. Yet it was you who took me from the womb. You kept me safe on my mother's breast. On you I was cast from my birth, and since my mother bore me, you have been my God. Do not be far from me, for trouble is near, and there is no one to help. Many bulls encircle me. Strong bulls of Bashan surround me. They open wide their mouths at me, like a ravening and a roaring lion. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax. It is melted within my breast. My mouth is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue sticks to my jaws. You lay me in the dust of my death. For dogs are all around me. A company of evil doers encircled me. My hands and feet have shriveled. I can count all of my bones. They stare and gloat over me. They divide my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots. But you, O Lord, do not be far away. O my help, come quickly to my aid. Deliver my soul from the sword, my life from the power of the dog. Save me from the mouth of the lion. From the horns of the wild oxen you have rescued me. You will tell of your name to my brothers and sisters. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you offspring of Jacob, glorify him. Stand in awe of him, all you offspring of Israel. For he did not despise or abhor the affliction of the afflicted. He did not hide his face from me, but heard when I cried to him. From you comes my praise in the great congregation. My vows will pay before those who fear him. The poor shall eat and be satisfied. Those who seek him shall praise the Lord. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth shall remain and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations shall worship before him. For dominion belongs to the Lord, and he rules over the nations. To him, indeed, shall all who sleep in the earth bow down. Before him shall bow down all who go down to the dust, and I shall live for him. Prosperity will serve him. Future generations will be told about the Lord, and proclaim his deliverance to a people yet unborn, saying that he has done it.